To discuss the real issues affecting Australia and New Zealand, this is Trad Tasman Talk, jointly produced by the Unshackled.net and the Mr. Berry Mr. Berry Show. Now here are Tim Wilms and Stephen Berry live from Melbourne.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to the third last episode of Trad Tasman Talk on this Friday, the 18th of November, 2022. I'm Tim Wilms, Editor-in-Chief of The Unshackled, live here in Melbourne, where it is 7 p.m.
And I'm Stephen Berry, contributor to the BFD.co.nz, also here in Victoria. And it's been a bit of good news for us, actually, in terms of COVID. The numbers of people being impacted by it are not quite what the big government control freaks would have liked.
Yes, the COVIDians. So the weekly, what is that, death toll or people dying with COVID was 120, only up 25. And even though hospitalizations are going up and cases are, ICUs are not. This, of course, is the new wave driven by, as the Commonwealth Australian Chief Medical Officer Paul Kelly said, the grandchildren of Omicron, though Health Minister Mark Butler calls them the cousins of Omicron. So there's, what is it, the recombinant XBB, and there is a BQ1, which is a BA5 a subvariant. And we've also got our own Aussiecron variant, BR1. So the only way that, only public information we have about what variants are circulating is the New South Wales Health Surveillance Report. And it's all a bit of a mix of everything, but BA4 and 5 are still large in circulation. Though I read an expert in the Age on Monday saying that all of these new grandchildren, cousins of Omicron, all struggling for fitness, shows that the virus could be on its last legs.
Yeah, I mean, I think we're getting to the stage where who cares about the new variants anyway. The disease certainly seems to be having a lesser and lesser impact.
Just don't try and force a mask on us, because that seems to be the COVIDians, the alarmists, the doomers. There's certainly still a large COVID cult following. They must like thrive on like this sort of doom, because they always eagerly post as bad a news as possible.
Yeah, well, I guess when they've spent the last 2.5 years eagerly demanding that we have more and more of our freedoms ripped away from us in response to COVID, only to find out now that perhaps we didn't need to be so hard and destroy people's lives in order to fight back against the virus, I guess it's a bit hard to take a step back and go, oops, maybe we were slightly wrong.
And monkeypox was a massive bust. This meme is going around tonight on Unsolved Mysteries. What happened to monkeypox? Well, I think
a bummer.
Yeah, I think I've explained this before, that the vaccines, the smallpox Gynos vaccine from Bavarian Nordic, it actually worked in stopping transmission, unlike the COVID vaccines. And the most at-risk group, men who have sex with men, because they wanted to keep on having sex with men, because you couldn't tell them to abstain, they had a very good incentive to keep getting vaccinated so they could get back to their orgies and sex parties.
I guess, in terms of the monkeypox vaccine, they've had a bit of an advantage because they've had longer than a couple of weeks to actually formulate it and get it out into the population.
Yeah, it was already developed. It was a third generation smallpox vaccine, so it had less side effects than the first two. they just had to mass produce that and distribute it to the people most at risk. And Lady of Shalott says that's their human right to orgy, and says there's a word for them, men. Well, the
sexuality is a spectrum now. You can't say
yes. Like, and this is the correct sexual health terminology: men who have sex with men. Because, well, what does the word gay or what is it homosexual mean anymore? Like, it's hard to.
No, actually, I won't say that. But, but yeah, exactly. Apparently, everything's on a spectrum now, and we're not stuck in one box or anything.
I saw that some of the alarmists' accounts they reported that there was a suspected Ebola case in the UK. Somebody who had recently traveled from Africa, because there's been an outbreak of the Sudanese strain of Ebola in Uganda. And apparently if somebody falls sick in the hospital who's traveled from Africa, they quarantine part of the hospital and deep clean it as a precaution. We won't know whether they have Ebola or what strain it is for a couple of days, but that sent the usual suspects into a frenzy, even though monkeypox wasn't airborne and Ebola's not airborne. So monkeypox was skin to skin, and Ebola is bodily fluids, so blood, semen, breast milk, large amounts of saliva.
Poo.
That's that sort of thing. Yes.
It's funny. Did we ever talk about variants of diseases before COVID? I don't recall it.
No, we didn't.
An expert on viruses.
But it's interesting, given that we've been through this COVID experience, where they initially called the UK strain, the Indian strain, but that was racist, so we gave them names.
The virus.
But for Ebola, they've got the Zaire strain, and they've got the Sudanese strain.
Zaire doesn't even exist anymore.
No, it's the Democratic Republic of the Congo, but it was Zaire, where it was first discovered. It was named after the Ebola River when it was first discovered. The scientist who discovered it called it the Ebola virus, so it wouldn't be associated with like the Congo.
No, and plus you've got the issue of the Republic of Congo, which is right next door to the Democratic Republic of Congo. So I guess calling it the Zaire virus is probably the easiest thing to do.
Lady of Shalott says, I think Ebola is the least of the UK's problems. Tim and Stephen, have you seen Jeremy Hunt's budget? It will break their back of the middle class. Yes. He's completed the Liz Truss U-turn and is going to increase taxes and all sorts of things.
Completely mental. And I mean, the only reason why the Liz Truss budget had such a negative effect on the economy was because the tax cuts were not costed, and there was no they were going to be paid for with borrowing, and there was also going to be an extra $60 billion over 2 years, £60 billion over 2 years in energy subsidies, which are also not funded. So, governments that spend themselves further into record deficits always upset markets. But then when they go and do a complete about face and give the markets no certainty, well, that just makes things even worse.
I can be pretty certain now with the globalist golden boy Rishi Sunak in charge, Prime Minister, and Jeremy Hunt, the globalist pro-CCP Remainer as Chancellor. The Tory boys are back in town.
Yeah, I would say that we're definitely witnessing the final term of this Conservative government. Which unfortunately means that the UK is probably about 6 or 7 years away from any sort of free market reforms, which will be forced upon it by economic collapse, much in the same way the Western world was in the late 70s.
Now, of course, As always, we're on the Unshackled and Right Minds YouTube channels, and we have Q&A at the end of the program where you can send through a direct question or send through a super chat. So even though the usual suspects have been lobbying for mask mandates, state or territory or federal government is interested. And of course, we have seen enough evidence that mask mandates do not make a difference to the COVID wave curve, which is why the pro-mask zealots advocates, they've come up with a new argument about why we should be masking in the West. So this is from Benjamin Veness. He is a Australian doctor based in New York now, who he published this study and he summarized it. Universal masking policies distribute a small cost across society rather than shifting the highest burdens of COVID-19 onto populations that have already been made vulnerable by structural racism and other inequalities. So apparently,
so is he saying that black people are more likely to get diseases? Because that sounds pretty racist.
Well, it seems to be that, maybe saying it in regards to COVID, that's just an extract that he's pulled, that onto populations that have already made vulnerable by structural racism and other inequalities. So yes, basically saying that the US term is populations of color are more vulnerable to adverse outcomes of COVID-19.
Except Asian people, apparently they're always the exception, it seems.
Oh, well, you should also wear a mask to show you're not a white supremacist and anti-Asian. This is from another Australian doctor based in New York. White people who are claiming this is a reach, Asian people have been violently attacked in Western countries for wearing masks. Western leaders have said wearing masks isn't in our culture. A lot of anti-mask sentiment is deeply embedded in white supremacy. So there you go.
Well, you know where they do like to wear masks? All the Muslim countries. In the Middle East, of course, only the women like to wear them.
Yes, the Taliban, they've even mandated that the female newsreaders have to wear veils. But as we saw with the COVID COVID clusters outbreaks in Australia, the veils didn't protect Muslim areas from having COVID cases.
No. It's interesting also, I seem to recall, you know, in the 1800s, particular racist groups liked to cover their faces as well, like the KKK.
And weren't various slaves forced to, like, wear muzzles?
Yes, yep, they were.
But and it's they always use this argument that they've been always wearing masks in Asia for flu and respiratory viruses, though
that's a bad thing. How is it because they're always getting sick over there, so it's fine.
Though anyone who's been to Asia pre-COVID will notice that even though there's a few here and there with masks, it's not on a mass population level. And the people who are wearing masks is because either they're sick and you're supposed to not be out if you're sick now. That's a new mantra. So that's actually bad that they're out and about and like when they should be staying home. And as we know that flimsy surgical masks don't stop respiratory viruses. And also Asian people have worn masks when pollution levels are high. And so that they're not coughing in smoke. And the reason why they've been more compliant during COVID wearing masks everywhere is because they're high trust societies. They trust their governments and experts. Well, here in the West, we have had years and decades of evidence about why we shouldn't trust our governments and experts as well. But the bottom line is, I mean, this is South Korea's COVID curve from November last year. And yeah, so universal masking hasn't stopped the high peaks. That's the first Omicron wave. That's the second one. And they're going through another one. And Japan's going through another one as well. So it seems like that's all they've got left is just, well, yeah, also, wear a mask to show, like, to show solidarity against, show solidarity with Asians and against racism, against Asians. Though also, wouldn't it be classified as cultural appropriation as well, wearing a mask? Like,
well, I think maybe Western leaders have noticed that even in China, which is the ultimate totalitarian society, which is still chasing the goal of zero COVID, residents there are in some cases in open rebellion when cities get put into lockdown yet again. So if the Chinese are starting to become resistant to those sorts of approaches, hopefully that's a sign for Western leaders to maybe back off.
We had this week the ABC's COVID commentator, Dr. Norman Swan, though he hasn't been a practicing doctor since about the 1970s. He's been the ABC's health commentator, but he's been probably the, well, he's got the taxpayer-funded platform, so therefore he is the most, one of the most influential COVID doomers. He said on ABC News Breakfast that he said it was too much of a coincidence that cricket legend Shane Warne and Kimberly, the late Labor Senator Kimberely Kitching, they both died at the age of 52 in March this year from heart attacks. It said that it was too much of a coincidence that they both passed after having COVID infections. Though the thing is that although Warney had COVID twice, Kimberly Kitching never tested positive for COVID. The only thing COVID-related thing that Shane Warne and Kimberly Kitching had in common was that they were both vaccinated. So he apologized, Norman Swan, and he apologized to Kimberly Kitching's late husband, Andrew Landaloo, though he hasn't apologized to the Warren family. So he certainly had finally some significant backlash against him.
Good. And so we're about a week away from the election day now, aren't we, in Victoria?
We've got one more bit of COVID related news is that Novak Djokovic, nicknamed Novak's Djokovic, has had his automatic 3-year visa ban from Australia overturned by the new federal immigration minister, Andrew Giles, so he will be able to participate in the 2023 Australian Open. So basically, I mean, good on the new immigration minister here for finally putting vaccine passports and the medical segregation fully behind Australia. And so it'll certainly hopefully be a better symbol when Novak Djokovic is playing in the 2023 Australian Open that Australia has moved on from its COVID madness.
And a pleasant surprise from a Labor immigration minister, really, when you consider the scenes in Parliament of Labor MPs screaming across the floor for their opponents to put their masks on, etc.
That was mainly the teal independent Monique Ryan. She's the main mask Karen. I mean, I haven't heard anything from the Labor Aged Care Minister Annika Wells since then. She's been spotted maskless pretty much most of the time since then. But yes, it was in the middle of this year, the new Labor government that removed the requirement for foreigners to be COVID vaccinated coming into Australia. So they got rid of that. So they've certainly made former Prime Minister Scott Morrison and former Immigration Minister Alex Hawke look like the biggest sanctimonious COVID zealots that the world has seen in 2022.
Well, aside from New Zealand's example, of course.
Well, New Zealand allows in unvaxxed foreigners now as well. New Zealand was always about 3 or 4 months behind Australia. I think New Zealand still has the 7-day isolation rule.
Yeah, I would have to double check. I confess that I've started losing interest after 2.5 years of this crap.
But we'll get back to, as you were attempting to move on to, the Victorian state election campaign, where the C word that we were just discussing, COVID, is hardly being mentioned by the incumbent Labor Premier Dan Andrews, who made Melbourne the most lockdown city in the world, and put a Victoria police, they fired rubber bullets at protesters and at the Shrine of Remembrance, and pepper sprayed old grannies.
It's interesting to see just how much the polls have tightened in this race, actually, in the last 2 weeks. 2 weeks ago, it was looking...
We haven't got another poll since the Redbridge poll in the Herald Sun on Monday. Now, Redbridge was funded by one of the former Labor campaign directors, Kos Samaras, who's married to a Labor MP. He's got pretty left-wing sympathies, but he's seen as a pretty accurate pollster. So, this is your poll of polls, so I'll let you run through it.
Yeah, so it includes the five most recent polls. So the Redbridge, the News poll, the Roy Morgan. I knew I should have written them down. Anyway, it's the five most recent polls, and they're all different sources. So Labor is now losing a bit of primary support, down 0.8 to 38%. Liberal and Nationals are up to 33.8, which is an increase of 4.1. The Greens just down mildly at 12.5%, and then the others and the Independents up 1.3% over the last 2 weeks to over 15%. So the two-party preferred is narrowing somewhat, though it's still quite a shellacking against the Liberals, 55.9 for Labor, 44.1 for the Coalition.
So we'll see if there's another news poll in the Australian this weekend, or Resolve Political Monitor in The Age. It's good because there hasn't been a poll for a number of days, so it'd be interesting to see where the polls stand. And there were not one but two television documentaries that aired this week that were critical of the Dan Andrews government. So first of all, on Monday evening, Liz Hayes' Under Investigation program that looked at Sluggate. So that was when Dan's chief health officer, Brett Sutton, shut down the catering business they supplied prepackaged meals for like aged care hospitals, iCook Foods. They were falsely accused of killing a woman in Knox Private Hospital with one of their sandwiches, which had listeria in it. They weren't the sole provider of food to that private hospital. What was the fatal blow for them was when a City of Greater Dandenong health inspector found a slug on the floor, though it looks like from the CCTV footage and just the what is known about slugs in that area, that it looks like the slug was planted there. And so the City of Greater Dandenong, they also had, they were part owners of iCook Foods main rival, Community Chef, which it seems so unfair that, well, and also, why does the government need to be in the food business? I mean, iCook Foods had been in business for 30 years. Why did they need to be a government-funded competitor to it?
Yeah, absolutely. I would like to see scandals named something other than Wordgate.
Oh, there and was...
It's been done hundreds of times now.
There was a bit of a change after Brexit, like when Meghan and Harry said they weren't going to become royals anymore. It was called a Megxit. So there was hope that the suffix would catch on, that it wouldn't just be gate all the time.
Yeah. Of course, the Brexit issue seems to have quietened down across Europe now too. So, I mean, even Italian Prime Minister stopped talking about Italians leaving the EU.
Well, on the subject of the state election, many Victorians are hoping for a Dan exit come November 26. So that was Monday night. And then Wednesday night on Sky News was Peter Credlin's documentary, The Cult of Dan Andrews, which talked about how over his 8 years of premiership, he's been able to appoint mates to Victoria Police, WorkSafe Victoria, his social media machine. He has close to 100 staffers working in his private office, which is nearly double the Prime Minister's staff.
Wow, and also, that's insane.
And also went through the car collision that the Andrews family car had with that 15-year-old cyclist in Bulgaria on the Mornington Peninsula back in 2013, and also when Dan slipped down we were led to believe was a huge staircase, but was just two steps. And so she also had a former minister in the Andrews government, her identity was obscured, talked about how if you go against Dan, you're put in the freezer, like he isolates you, like he metaphorically gives the first punch and then others finish the job against you.
And yet, despite all that, we're still looking at a very comfortable Labour victory next week.
Well, that is what I think. Even the most fulgurant when I say anti Dan, I mean there's so many reasons to hate Dan. Even those people are keeping their expectations very low. I mean they're not getting their hopes up at all. They still expect to wake up on November 27 with Dan Andrews still the premier. This was one of the anti-Dan ads. There was another Ditch Dan fundraiser by the Victorian Liberal Party in the last 24 hours. So they put out an ad about the Dan Andrews hangover after Election Day.
Oh, no. What did we do yesterday?
Your vote has consequences.
We're going to pay for this one.
Don't wake up with an Andrews hangover. Vote Liberal. Authorised by Seema Queston, Liberal Melbourne.
Well, if the results go badly on election night, like as everyone knows, during the Unshackled election night live streams, we have alcohol on. I think that if it does go the way that a lot of us are hoping, will drink heaps to celebrate and have a hangover the next day, or drink regardless? Either it'd be drown sorrows or celebrate.
Yeah, and unfortunately, I won't be able to take part in that next week as I've now got work. But yeah, I suspect that will probably be the only way to get through the night otherwise.
I noticed that a difficult nerd on Twitter, James Newbury, has said that if Satan himself was running against Daniel Andrews promising fire and brimstone enemas for all eternity, it would still be the lesser of two evils. Vote this bloke out. Would you rather, like, if you're given the option, vote for Satan or Dan Andrews?
Even those unions which criticizing the Andrews government, such as the firefighters union, they're not really providing any alternatives that people should vote for this election.
Let us know in the chat if you'd vote for Dan Andrews or Satan. I mean, I'm not a Christian, so like I don't believe in God or the devil, but yeah, it's...
Well, maybe vote for the devil in that case, and then we won't have a premier. That would be wonderful.
Well, James Newbury, this is a difficult nerd. The reason why I say James Newbury difficult nerd because the Liberal member for Brighton is also called James Newbury, spelt with a Y, so there's two James Newburys. So this James Newbury difficult nerd, he's openly homosexual, so like, well, he's a sinner in the eyes of like God if he exists. So what is that, if the devil likes homosexuality, then he has that in common with the devil. I'm just talking hypothetically here, if you know, God.
Back on topic. Speaking of deviant politicians, what's this about the shadow treasurer being caught out following dodgy Facebook groups?
Oh yes, this is quite funny. So David Davis, who made headlines earlier this year by getting too drunk at a, I think was it some sort of like, you know, political swanky community event, and so
what Australian politician doesn't do that?
A women's rights activist group has revealed that several front benches are following risque accounts, including Playboy Playmates, Linga models, and women who appear on OnlyFans, a subscription website largely used by sex workers. The Herald Sun reported that David Davis, the shadow treasurer, is among three men to be enthralled in the scandal, with the shadow treasurer using his publicly verified Twitter account to follow Whore of You, which celebrates the history of prostitution. Well, I think it was the Kennett government in Victoria which first decriminalized brothels in Victoria, so maybe it's just celebrating the Liberal legacy. Obviously Dan Andrews has fully legalized sex work in Victoria, so it goes further down here. On Instagram, he's followed Melbourne Boudoir by Karen, which is a photography page, women posing in lingerie. So the Herald Sun reached out to Liberal Party with screenshots of them following the accounts dubbed a sleaze file. And they said that Labor is out of touch on ideas. There's an election in 12 days about the future of our state. And the best thing they can do is troll through who likes what on social media page. And Brad Batten, who's the shadow police minister, had been following an OnlyFans model through TikTok, which showed videos of her taking a top off to real itty bitties. The young woman charges men, well, there might be women who are interested in her as well, per month on the subscription-based site for more revealing adult content. Sky News Australia does not suggest Mr. Batten has paid access to the site. Brighton MP, the other James Newbury, was also caught up in the scandal after the file revealed he followed three bikini models on Instagram.
That's well, I mean, I wouldn't give a shit, but pretty silly. How could you possibly make that mistake with your public account?
Well, we obviously had the infamous incident where on the night when the same sex same-sex marriage law survey results were announced, which was 5 years since this week. Liberal Defence Minister Christopher Pyne, who was pro same-sex marriage, liked some gay porn on his Twitter and claimed the next day that he was hacked.
Oh, yes, I remember that.
Yes, yes. And you've heard how Christopher Pyne speaks. He speaks like this, Christopher Pyne.
And I can't remember the name of the government minister who commented on it the next day.
Who called for an inquiry.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was his, what's it, former South Australian Liberal factional rival, Corey Bernardi, who said, we need an investigation to see how far and deep this penetration has been.
Awesome.
Yeah, but I think I've mentioned before that the internal probe into that he concluded that the only way for Christopher Pyne's Twitter account to like that gay porn was if somebody took the phone from his pocket, opened it, he got into his Twitter app, liked it, then closed the phone and put it back in Christopher Pyne's pocket. So, yes, it was a very, you know, very sophisticated, like it was a real life hack. But, of course, you know, Christopher Pyne, he's a good Catholic, married with four children, so.
Yeah, the lisp is just a coincidence.
But going on to more serious scandals, well, should I say controversies, so. You've probably heard Stephen, but probably don't understand how in Victoria's upper house, it's the only state upper house that still has group voting tickets. So in Victoria, there's 40 seats in the upper house. There is 8 regions with 5 members each, proportional representation. They're up for the whole chamber is up for election every 4 years, so you can vote one above the line or number the individual boxes at least 1 to 5 below the line. But if you vote above the line, then the parties decide where your preference goes. Now, this used to be the system in place for the federal Senate elections in Western Australia, South Australia, New South Wales, upper house, but everywhere else, including at the federal level, got rid of group voting tickets because of this man, the preference whisperer, Glenn Drury, who for years has been doing what's known as preference harvesting. So he's even been involved in like registering other political parties for the sole purposes of feeding preferences to other minor parties, because there have been lots of cases of parties being elected with less than 1% of the vote, even though the quota is, well, in Victoria for an upper house seat, it's 16.67. So Heston Russell and another one of his party, is Heston Russell, who's the founder of the Australian Values Party, so Angry Victorians is an offshoot of that. The leader of the Angry Victorians Party, Chris Burson, they were on a Zoom call with Glenn Drury, who basically explaining how he charges for him arranging their preferences. And if they win, then there's a $50,000 commission. None of this is new to me, because I knew of Glenn Drury when I was in the Liberal Democrats. So yeah, he's been a known person in the minor party scene for years, but it's really blown up because, well, Victoria is still the only state with them, and he helped set up, Glenn Drury admits, the Sac Dan Andrews Party to draw preference votes away from the other anti-Dan parties. So the Freedom Party of Victoria, United Australia Party, Pauline Hanson's One Nation, and the Liberal Democrats.
No, I guess if Australia didn't have compulsory voting, maybe the quality of the voters might improve, and he would have less of an impact on election results.
Because in the last Victorian state election, 90% of Victorian voters voted above the line. So this is why the Liberal Democrats were able to win two seats, the Transport Matters, Sustainable Australia Party, the Jaron Hinch's Justice Party were able to win three seats. I'm not sure who I'm leaving out. So at the federal level, in 2016, the Liberals and the Greens, they voted together to abolish group voting tickets. Labor voted against it. And so Glenn Drury explains how the Labor Party likes these group voting tickets because they do deals to get these minor parties into the upper house so they can get a crossbench that they can work with. And the minor parties, they run in marginal seats to preference Labor. So it's a quid pro quo. But this is all legal. But obviously it's considered quite abhorrent to people who believe in the value of a vote.
See, I think it's strange that Victoria's entire upper house is also up for re-election at the same time the lower house is. I would have thought you would have to do it at different times.
It's so that because we have fixed four-year terms, so that if you're elected to the upper house, you're not in there for a plum eight-year term, like in South Australia and New South Wales, because 8 years, a guaranteed 100K plus salary, that's pretty good. And you can never be like booted from it unless you go to prison, basically. Dan Andrews denied that he's ever met Glenn Drury, the preference whisperer, though it was revealed today his chief of staff, Lizzie Ratcliffe, had, but Dan Andrews said that was just in relation because he was a staffer for the Darren Hinch Justice Party, and so it was about staffing for minor parties in the parliament. It wasn't about preferences. Though, you know what Dan Andrews is really mad about? He's mad that the Liberals are apparently preferencing racist and Nazis. And this is what he said yesterday, and which I'll play. He also said the same thing today. I won't play that because it's basically the same thing. But this was his bold claim.
In their preference decisions, the Liberal Party are preferencing people who are not just anti-Semites, but they are Nazis. They are racists, and there is no place for the alternative government in this great state, the beacon of multiculturalism in our nation. There is no place for the alternative government of this state to be in a political partnership with people who have absolutely abhorrent views. Racists, plain and simple. And I intend to make sure that the Victorian community knows about that, because they're the decisions that have been made.
No, and of course, it's never going to backfire on him, is it? Because
labeling
people the most horrible things you can just makes them join your party.
Yeah. Like, can he name these racist, anti-Semitic parties and candidates? Like, in regards to the, like, today you went on about parties that believe in conspiracy theories, which, well, most conspiracy theories are true these days.
Oh, in Victoria, they seem to be.
Yeah, they're proven true in about 3 months. So the Freedom Party of Victoria, I mean, one of the main faces of the Freedom Party is Morgan C. Jonas, who is Jewish. I mean, he can't be a anti-Semite. I mean, he clearly doesn't hate himself. And also
Avi Yemeni as well.
He's not running, but he's a longtime mate of Morgan Morgan Jonas. So, and
seem to recall he's called himself a Nazi Jew or something like that.
Ironically, he said at a Tommy Robinson rally, ironically, I'm the proudest Jewish Nazi. Well, he's wearing a yarmulke. So, you know, but of course, like the Avi's enemies took that literally. United Australia Party, the Victorian UAP Senator Ralph Babbitt is from, well, Mauritius. I mean, he's clearly brown. His brother Matt, who, well, because they're brothers, is brown as well, is running as a candidate at the state level as well. That's like, so clearly then they don't have all white candidates, and the Liberal Democrats, they're running a Jewish candidate in Caulfield. They've had a number of Jewish people run for them over the years. So I don't know Dan, I don't think there was any follow-up about, you know, name them.
No, definitely not. And I mean, I'm surprised that he would try that sort of strategy anyway, because when you attack the voters of other political parties, all you really do is polarise the situation. You don't improve your own support.
Pete Osiman says, the only Nazi-like group I've seen is the Andrews government. Yes. Whose police force surrounded synagogues last year during lockdown because they suspected that Jews were unlawfully praying? And who scapegoated the Jews for rising COVID cases because of a Jewish engagement party during lockdown? I mentioned this on Monday's program because I couldn't believe that there was some rabbi who invited Dan to speak, and so he was heckled and said, "We remember what you did to us last year." So yes, that's who I've seen persecute the Jews this past 12 months. The Andrews government, and well, they've been the most high profile inciters of anti-Semitism, because that Jewish couple had that engagement party during lockdown, they got so much anti-Semitic abuse, which you can say was inspired by Dan targeting them. They were forced to leave the country.
And in any case, I would say that it's the most the most poisonous anti-Semitism frequently comes from the left, as they support the terrorist state of Palestine. It's not even a state. They support the terrorists that run Palestine.
Well, I see out of that conflict. I mean, it's nothing to do with us.
Well, yeah.
But yes, I mean the Palestinian Authority. They're hardly, you know, libertarians.
Yeah, they're hardly advocates of freedom.
Yes. With these preference whisperer revelations, Liberals have referred it to IBAC, the broad-based anti-corruption commission, which means that the Victorian Liberal Party, they already have to update their frequent liar cards, which they launched on Sunday at their campaign launch, because they had here, I'll just bring it up now. They had Dan Andrews as this was quite, I thought it was a very clever bit of campaign marketing. So his number is IBAC 05. It needs to be IBAC 06 now. I saw that Jason Wood, Federal Liberal MP, said that with this 6 IBAC investigation, he's a lifetime member of the frequent liar club. Victorian Liberal Party, Matthew Guy, and well, he is the earlier this year, it was revealed that Dan Andrews, well, now former chief of staff, Mick Catlin, had tried to get a $100,000 in payment for his private business from a party donor, which could possibly breach Victoria's donation laws, which are capped at $1,000 per year, so $4,000 over an electoral cycle. So the VEC put out quite an extraordinary statement saying that they were going to be referring the matter to IVAC, saying that they hadn't received satisfactory responses from anybody. So the state director of the Liberal Party, Sam McQuesten, said that the VEC should cease and desist in any public further commentary about this matter, either official or unofficial, for the remainder of the campaign, because they believed it was a very incendiary statement. And what was, well, it's still left unambiguous, like what is a not a satisfactory response? I mean, she refused to name it. The VEC's communications game director on 3AW this morning just said, oh, well, that's just what the statement says, and didn't go into it.
I mean, but the caps on donations are ridiculous anyway.
I know.
The problem isn't people donating to political parties. The problem is politicians having power to sell. If Parliament didn't have the powers it had, it probably wouldn't incentivize these large donations anyway. That's where the corruption really comes from.
The Teal candidates, they took the VEC to VCAT, the Civil and Administrative Tribunal, for refusing to register their how-to-vote cards because they didn't want to allocate preferences, so they just put a one next to their name and said number the others according to your preference. The VEC said because they showed blank boxes that it would cause more informal votes, even though at the Australian federal election, well, the Teals won Goldstein and Kooyong, so clearly they got enough formal votes, despite them having the same how-to-vote cards, though they're not required to be registered federally. Victoria has all of these quite onerous election laws. The electoral commissioner, actually, Warwick Gately, has taken stress leave, like, in the final week of the campaign. He's on leave. It's like taking stress leave in the grand final after you've played all season.
Yeah, it'd be like me taking stress leave in Christmas week.
And also, on 3AW, Sue Lang from the VEC said that, oh, because there's so many early votes, we might not be able to count them all on election night. But, like, you already knew that there was probably going to be more early votes, so couldn't you have planned for this? Like, there's more and more people.
Can you not count them before election night?
Apparently not. No. Before, like, back pre, like in the 2010 state election, they didn't count the early votes until after election night. So I actually encourage people to vote on election day, so your vote is counted quicker. And obviously, if you want to decide where your preferences go in the upper house, vote below the line as well. Like, obviously, under Victorian electoral law, I can't tell people how to vote, but I certainly will provide information so that people know their voting options. They can vote above the line or below the line, and obviously in the lower house you have to number every box.
Isn't that ironic? In a democratic election, you aren't allowed to tell people how to vote.
Otherwise, I'd have to authorize, politically authorize what I say, because Andrew Bogut, the Australian basketball legend and Dan critic, he got a warning letter from the VEC because he linked to a, vote them out website against the the minor parties that passed Dan's pandemic laws. Like, obviously, I do not like Dan Andrews and hope he's not premier after November 26th, but I'm not telling anyone how to vote on their ballot paper. So yes, that's the environment how we have to operate with all of these various electoral regulations.
Well, now, are we going to move on to the current G20 summits?
Well, it's summit season. So first there was the East Asia Summit, ASEAN Summit in Cambodia. And, joining the global leaders has been Klaus Schwab of the World Economic Forum with one of his global leaders, your Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern. He was also at the B20. So there's a spin-off from the G20, the B20, where the globalist business leaders gather. So Klaus Schwab opened that. And there was the Australian business representatives. So there was Jennifer Westacott from Business Council of Australia and Innes Wilcox from Australian Industry Group. I don't know how do you get an invite to this like globalist business summit? So that's just concluded, the G20. And Anthony Albanese had a 32-minute sit-down with Chinese President Xi Jinping. So it was the first.
I guess he's not going to tell us what happened in there.
No, he doesn't want to get a public dressing down like Xi gave Justin Trudeau. So Anthony Albanese just said, we'll just have further dialogue, because it was a much significant meeting, because it's the first meeting between the Australian and Chinese leaders in 6 years. And Jacinta is going to be meeting with Xi at APEC. So APEC's in Thailand. So they're all at the same time. So it's all of these
good to keep meetings. Her out of the country, I guess. Though, of course, North Korea, this has just come out in the last couple of hours. North Korea's managed to get a bit of attention by firing another intercontinental missile from it during the G20. I should have read this better. So now all the Western allies are meeting to discuss North Korea again.
I saw that Jacinta condemned it. I mean, it's pretty easy to stand up to Kim Jong-un, but not easy for her to stand up to Xi. I noticed that in Dan Andrews' own seat of Mulgrave, he put Kim Jong-un quite low on his how to vote card preferences, because Kim Jong-un impersonator Howard X. Lee is running against Dan. His pitch is, you know, have the real thing, have the real dictator.
I did see a video about that yesterday.
Yes, so Big Kim is quite busy campaigning in Mulgrave and also firing interballistic missiles. At least it didn't hit Poland like that Ukrainian missile did.
Yeah, that was a bit unfortunate.
Yes, it was called a Russian-made missile, but yes, it came from Ukraine. But we also had at the G20 French President Emmanuel Macron still griping over former Prime Minister Scott Morrison cancelling the submarine contract with France in favour of the AUKUS nuclear submarines. So yeah, he's still banging on about it, Emmanuel Macron, even though, you know, Scott Morrison's nowhere to be seen. His argument was that, because they weren't going to be nuclear subs, that means that it wasn't going to inflame China like the AUKUS subs will. So basically, I mean, Macron is already tried to appease Putin, and now, you know, he's doing the same thing, trying to appease Xi as well.
Maybe he saw an opportunity with the change of government.
So we've already reached the hour here. We should have a bit of New Zealand news just to finish the show. So apparently, New Zealand schools, they're becoming a massive problem.
I mean, they've generally always been pretty crap in the public sector, but truancy is becoming a massive issue.
Which is also known as wagging. That's the Australian terminology.
So now it's actually gotten so bad that just 40% of school students are actually attending school regularly in New Zealand. So that means that they're taking less than one half day off a week, which is incredible. National Party leader Christopher Luxon's created a bit of controversy as he was talking about the issue on the AM show with Ryan Bridge a couple of days ago. He said that the standards set by school leadership are a mixed bag around the country, which is it's a pretty soft sort of thing to say, I would think. But this is... resulted in outrage from school principals associations who are adamant that it's not the principal's fault, and there's all sorts of other challenges involved, and how dare he criticise educators. But David Seymour of the ACT Party was asked about this morning on the AM show, and this was brilliant. And he's been asked what he thinks of Luxon's comments, and he says, well, as the member, the MP for Epsom, he sees just about every school principal in his electorate each year. He says, while many of them are excellent, some of them are actually absolutely hopeless. And he even goes as far as citing the example of the head of a Waitakere president, Waitakere Principals Association's comments on social media and explicitly identifying him as an example of a useless school principal. So, I mean, I think that's quite wonderful, actually. What do you think of Luxon's comments? Well, I'm going to double down on his comments and explicitly target some of the principals. ACT also talked about their $250 million Teaching Excellent Reward Fund. This will be allocated to schools, but based on the number of teachers they have. Yes, yeah. I mean, I know David well enough to think that maybe he's actually deliberately trolling here, because yes, the $250 million fund for paying good teachers more. The acronym is TURF, so I think they've done quite well with this one.
Yes, because TURF also stands for Trans Exclusionary Radical Feminist, so it's certainly good to turf out bad principles, and if you can, well, any, you know, type of feminism is bad, even TURF. So yes.
It's a good policy in the sense that it allocates money to each school based on the number of teachers they have to pay good teachers more, because just about every organisation, whether it be charities or businesses or public sector, have goals as an organisation, and so surely it's school principals are capable of identifying teachers which more closely align with the goals of their organisation and rewarding them more. I don't see why this is controversial in education, where it's done just about everywhere else.
Who is interviewing him, this Māori newsreader with the face tattoo, who your foreign minister has one as well? We're told that this is, you know, part of their culture. Did they have tattoos before British settlement?
Oh, they definitely did, yes. In fact, after colonisation, the sale of preserved heads with these tattoos was quite popular anyway. And so, of course, there are a number that were appearing in European museums for many years. Whereas in the 90s, then the government in New Zealand started lobbying for these to be returned as cultural taonga. But even prior to colonisation, it was common for warring tribes to behead their opponents' prisoners and keep the heads as a prize as a result of these tattoos. I'm not familiar with the newsreader, though.
Oh, okay. But yes, clearly there's, what is it? It's
growing in popularity.
Yes. All right. Unless anyone in the audience has a question or super chat, we will wrap up the show. It's quite a busy 8 days coming up. So tomorrow, the Unshackled will be live streaming at the Worldwide Freedom Rally number 10, which in Melbourne, which its local name is Dan Andrews Must Go. Victorians stands united against Dan Andrews and the Victorian Labor government. So it'll start at Parliament House at 12 p.m. Melbourne time. And the 19th of November is also International Men's Day. So obviously International Women's Day is a huge deal beginning of March. It was first observed in Soviet Russia after the Russian Revolution, International Women's Day, but International Men's Day is tomorrow. I mean, it's good that they're still called, there's still a Men's Day and a Women's Day as well as Father's Day. And obviously we have the state election on Saturday, November 26th. So the Unshackled's live stream will start at 6 p.m. Melbourne time on the Unshackled's YouTube channel and Odyssey. And although Stephen won't be able to join us, Nick Patterson will be joining us. He is a trial. He stands accused of assaulting Victoria police officers when they attacked an anti-lockdown protester back in May 2021. That trial has been adjourned until next year. Sort of suspicious that they didn't want the trial during the state election campaign. So Nick will be on the panel. And also next Friday, it'll be our penultimate second last program, will also be Black Friday, which is the crazy sales day, the day after Thanksgiving in the United States, because there's all these worldwide shopping, worldwide online shopping platforms like Amazon, eBay. They all have their Cyber Black Friday madness.
Yeah, and I mean, there's a lot of criticism over the behavior of people shopping on that day, and I can see why, but let's compare it to, I don't know, a communist country in which people behave very well when they go to the shops, but they're queuing for several hours in the hopes that they might get some stale bread or...
Yes, yes. Well, like, still Boxing Day sales are the biggest thing here. Like, you're shopping for, like, consumer goods that, well, you want but don't necessarily need.
Yeah, yeah. So, I mean, sure they could behave themselves a bit better when they go shopping, but fuck, let's celebrate the fact that there's something actually worth fighting for at our stores, which is not the case in many other countries.
Well, like, it shows just how much of a abundance we are, and well, we just hope that's not under threat with the climate policies. Obviously, Europe, their energy supply will be challenged this winter. Inflation has made food and meat more expensive, which is why they're trying to sell people eating bugs. So, yes, I mean, like, it's challenging times here with food becoming more expensive, and like we hope that we haven't hit the peak where, you know, we can buy all of this, you know, where we're so wealthy that we could buy all this extra stuff that we don't necessarily need, and, you know, we could all afford food.
Yeah, well, as I made the case in my BFD column this week, it been identified that the impact on carbon emissions as a result of lockdowns, it actually dropped it by about the amount that it needs to drop every year until 2050 for us to achieve net zero global emissions. So when you consider that just 2 months of the steps taken regarding lockdowns in New Zealand resulted to a drop of 10% in economic growth in the first quarter. You know, we've got the roadmap to how we can reduce emissions, but is it something we really want to do?
Well, we'll soon find out how high the cost is. I mean, the globalists, they were still obviously jet set around the world to their various summits. I mean, they just had the Coca-Cola COP27. I don't know if there was any sponsors of summit season. Maybe FTX was going to be a sponsor of one of them, but obviously that's gone bust now with all the people's money going missing, and we don't know where Sam Bankman-Fried is. All right. Thank you, everyone, for watching. Two shows to go. I'll be back on Monday for Tim's News Explosion, 8:30 p.m. Melbourne time on the Wilms Front channels. And, of course, live tomorrow at the Worldwide Freedom Rally 10, Dan Andrews Must Go Rally. So I'll see you all then. Good night.
Good night.
Thanks for tuning in to this week's edition of Trad Tasman Talk. Keep up with the latest real news and analysis from the Tasman Nations. Visit theunshackles.net and rightminds.nz.